Yeah, hello everybody. It's a great pleasure for me to tell you somehow a continuation of our project. 2.5 years ago, I already reported about this citizen science project, which started actually in 2019 and was finished last year in February, this year in February. So some things have happened in the last 2.5 years, so it's okay. So the title was Kati and Franzi. I have to explain it, I think. Kati stands for Kataster Tirol, and but it also stands for Katharina. So this was one thing, and the other thing is that Franziszeischer Kataster, so this is Franz II, and it's somehow a bit funny to call him Franzi, because that's the smaller form of Franz, and this was the main idea, to have clear names for the interfaces. What you see here was the main idea of the project, that we wanted to use Transcribus to recognize all the documents of a collection, which I will show you later on a bit more in detail, and to set up a first search interface so that people can very early search the documents they are interested in this case, land registers. And the idea was to have first this searchable version. Actually, this was the very first read and search interface. And then to go on with citizen science and to go on with more that the scientists add more data to the database. But actually it was so successful, or the project was so successful, and the citizen scientists were working so quickly that we said, okay, we will not publish this search interface, but simply focus on the citizen science project. So that's the reason why you will not see very much of Transcribus in this project. Transcribus was this first search interface, but you really will get some information now on the citizen science project itself. The background is what we call the Franziszeian Kataster. It's the first land register in Austria, so the real land register combining maps with a rather high resolution, 1 to 2880, and the register where the owner is mentioned, the name of the owner, the number of the parcel, the type of usage of the parcel, which is very interesting, of course, if you know it was a house or it was a meadow or a wood or whatever. And the size of the project could be rather large, so the whole of the Austrian-Hungarian Empire was actually recorded with this cataster. And it took about 50 years actually, and it's about the size of today's Germany. But of course we are concentrating just on a very small part of this, just the northern part of Tyrol, so actually where we are here. All together these are likely more than 30 million parcels for whole Austro-Hungarian part, but about 1.5 million here for Tyrol. The digitization of the maps actually took place some time ago. It was done by the Bundesamt für Eich- und Vermessungswesen, so by the Austrian government. But the land registers themselves, so where the interesting information is was recorded, this was something which was not available so far and was part of the project to digitize these documents. These were about 180,000 pages which were needed to be digitized and then run through Transcribus and made available via searching. Now the actual CATI project is the citizen science project, and we support the users a little bit with AI, so they can see the transcription, but most of them can read the current writing rather well, so they usually don't need it, and it's really a manual task. The manual task consists of actually two subtasks. One is to underline the parcel in the map, and the other one is actually to record the data from the land register. The as I said, the project started in late 2019 with a prototype version and became really progressive some months later, so mainly in early 2020, and now it's running on a very stable basis, so that we hope to conclude it in 2025. Here are some results which are very similar to what we have heard before. We also never tried to involve a lot of people, but we tried to involve people who are really committed. In our case, this was rather simple, because we have here in Tyrol the situation that each commune appoints person which is called the local chronicler, so someone who cares about the local history of the commune. And these are typically very similar to what we have heard before, retired people, typical teachers or public servants and others, who feel somehow responsible for the history of their local region. And most of them were really easy to convince that they take part in this project. As you can see here, five of them did about two-thirds of the work. Also, this is very typical for this kind of citizen science projects, that only a small portion of people is really, really enthusiastic and working very hard. And there is even one person, she is really amazing, she did never stop. I don't have the figures for now, but at least within 9 months, she spent about 1,100 hours. So it's a lady, and she's about 65. I think she has, she's not retired, so she always stayed at home. And she simply loves to put in data, is a very modest person, would never try to get audience for her work, but just does it for her own reward. These data are from where we had a closer look for the 9 months from September 2020 to June 2021, and as you can see, about 312,000 entries were made, and this is was somehow a fifth of what we expected that will be necessary. But yeah, the success, so from our point of view, the project is really a great success, and we try to identify some of the success factors. First of all, I would say it's really also the type of source. I will show it later on to you. It's simply nice. Yeah, it's simply very beautiful maps. You get such a lot of information out of it. You have access to these maps, which is not that easy usually to get on the internet, and you can connect it with the data so that the information is even more fruitful and more interesting. And that's, from my point of view, really, really one thing. It's not boring, it's interesting. Then, these local people who are interested, who are willing to work, and the main thing really which is important for them is this kind of acknowledgement that they get both on the local side, so the mayor of the commune and friends and other people know that they are working on this, so there is a kind of thank you culture from this side. Of course, we try to support them, and I think it was also a good decision to tell them that we will not proofread actually their work, because it would have been too much work for us. We got €200,000 for developing the technical background, but we got hardly some money actually to support them dedicated people. And so we trusted on them and on their quality, and they are really, really trying to provide a good quality. And they know, of course, each other, so they are also asking each other if there are problems. And of course, they come to the main supporter, in our case, is Gerhard Siegel, a historian, who is also personally interested in this, and that's the person they always can ask. Also, Miriam supports them on the technical level. There is some acknowledgement by the university, so we invited them for a similar public event, and this will go on, of course, once we go to the public in a more official way. And the other thing was that I think we provided a simple interface, also a very simple organization. People know I'm responsible for this and that, mainly my own commune. They have to really commit themselves, so they have to write an email to us and say, I want to do this commune. And then they are somehow responsible. They can add other people to build up a workforce, but usually they work one or two people in one commune. So, and then the interface didn't change very much, so after first adaptations, that's stayed stable, and it's working rather simple. I will show you. Yeah, the first level support was done mainly by phone and email. For recruiting the people, we also used workshops, face-to-face workshops, where we invited them and introduced the program to them. Here you see the start page, an overview of the map of the communes where you need to type in the parcel number, and here's input for the protocols. But I try to give you now a demo so that you get a real understanding how it works, if it works.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's like somewhere. Oh, now the university says no.
Now you said no, you have to say yes.
It's like the university not willing to let us do that.
Sorry, your. I can try.
have it in mind, like, yeah, I need to enter probably.
Ah, no. Meinen kriegen wir nicht dran.
I can probably go in.
Okay, great. Okay, so this is the start page, what people see, yeah, the information is rather simple. It's called a web platform for users. It's just in German, and here you see the progress which was done in the last 24 hours, so about 934 entries were made, 9,000 in the last 7 days, 35,000 in the last 30 days, and nearly 800,000. So we reached already half of what we think is the whole number. You see the most active users of the last 7 days, the most active projects. And if you are, if you want to take part, then it's really very, very simple to write an email and to get the links to the communes. If you're logged in, then you can see, this is not public, but just for people who are registered, and you can see who has worked what. So you can see that Gerhard Siegel did nearly 180,000 entries, 22%. It's not totally fair. She is much more busy and has done a lot more because she did the harder stuff. So here, 135 more. And all the others you can see also per project. Project means here in this case commune. And you can also see the activities from the very beginning of the project. So this was the beta phase. And then people really started to work. They were actually finished. It was not summer in this case that nothing happened, but it was mainly that the maps were not available. And then we were able to connect all the maps, and so people were really happy and working enthusiastically. And again, there was a workshop, and new people started to work. Now, if someone wants to work, he would go actually to the commune and here see a page with the tasks, so a short description. Again, he could see the other users who has worked on that, the activities in for this project, some information, and so on and so on. And then here, the Aufgaben, the tasks. One task, as I said, is to mark the number within the parcels. So that's the nice task. You see the map, and what we do is to underline the parcel number and to provide the data. And that's simply done here. So you just put this line and type in the name, the number, and that's it, more or less. So that can be done quickly. And the other task requires a bit more time and is about the land registers. The land registers are divided between buildings and real estate. So here you see also the status of the parcels, so we could go for new and select the page. Here you see the land register with the parcel number, the names, the profession of the person, the address, then the type of usage of the parcel, the size of the parcel, and sometimes some remarks. And 3 years ago, we didn't have actually table recognition. So we used a very, very simple system. Today, of course, we would solve this in a much more convenient way. We would run or we would train a table recognition, and then we are sure that we would get very good results on the table cells. But at that time, this wasn't possible, so we followed a similar approach that we said, okay, you mark the line where you were working or where you are working, and then you get a form, but it seems to have a problem because it opens in a new window. Usually it's shown here, so I think that has to do with the presentation. So here opens simply a form where people can type in, but the form could be pre-filled if we would have actually the table recognition included. And one of the important thing is that people can copy the data, which makes it much faster for them actually to work. And because of course the owner and sometimes the usage type and so on stay the same, and you can optimize this. So this is Kati, and as I said, people are working with this and entered 800,000 records. So let's go on with this. Franzi is now the idea to use this data and to make a public interface for searching. We are working on this since more than a year, and we had several attempts. Probably at the beginning we tried to build up a kind of dashboard. We were very ambitious. We wanted to have filters, diagrams, tables, and all should work together. But that became really a bit complicated and not really user-friendly from my point of view, and also a lot of bugs were included. So we made a cut and said, okay, let's do it in a very, very simple way. Just provide a browse and search interface, but you are able to search for all the data from the records, for names, professions, communes, and so on. Of course, to link the database with the map, and to provide all data for a free download as a CSV file for the public. So we orientated all also a little bit on Google Maps, and so maybe you could call it Google Maps for cadastre data. That's how it looks like, and I will show you now the prototype. So what you can see here the red, so the colors are maybe not that nice, but red means that it's still under in progress, and blue means that the commune is already done. And here is a simple search interface, and we can type in a name like Josef, a very popular name in Austria, and the first level shows you 187 communes, I think, where Josef can be found, and we could look at the commune. We could also directly search Josef and the commune. Now it should have, yeah, so we find here just the Josefs in Wilton, and we can show the parcels. So here we see now the parcels selected from Josef. I can't read it from here, unfortunately, but you see the names, and you see also here V means Vulgo, so that's the house name. In Tyrol, many people had the names also of their houses, and you see also the profession, so e.g. Bauer, so farmer. And you could even select this, and then it selects just the farmers. And in this way, we try to make it convenient for the users to see what is actually there. If we click away, the search, then we get all the data which are already typed in, and we can also have a closer look. We could filter, e.g. for Wohngebäude, so for building, or for other parts. And of course we can look what is this parcel, or if I'm interested in this parcel, it should also work. Yeah, so that's the simple interface, more or less, and that's what we will provide to the public, likely in the next 2 or 3 months, I would say. It's already working, but some things probably need to be improved. Yeah, I think this was it from my side. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Are there any questions? Yeah. Microphone is coming. yeah,
thank you.
Exactly.
So thank you, Günther, for this wonderful presentation. As I told you yesterday, we had quite some success with using your own baseline model training to actually automatically transcribe these annotations on maps. Is this something you would consider doing before releasing the product, or perhaps in the future as an update to the current system?
I think for this project we will not touch it. We don't have any resources anymore, so it's really running on a I do it as part of my university job, and also the others are doing it just as part of their job, so there is no money around. So yeah, it would be nice, because it would of course speed up the process for the volunteers, but yeah.
Right, I think we had a question right in front of you. Here we are.
Yes, thank you, Günther. I was wondering, I cannot read the URL, but is this a public thing we can look at
yes,
home?
Yes, you can.
Yeah. Can you spell it or increase the font size?
Drop me an email and I will send it to you. We keep it a bit, we don't want to make it really public, but of course, if you're interested, I'm fine.
Yes, we have heard now, let's say, different strategies how to handle the quality assurance of, let's say, the crowd working place, from, let's say, having proofing or having not. I'm wondering if you have considered double keying in some project. Maybe you or the former speakers can also give an answer.
Thank you for this question. I think that's really important. It probably depends on the data, of course, but I think citizen science projects really are helpful if there is no proofreading from someone else, yeah? Because you will experience that e.g. Yolanda Griesmeier, which typed in 130,000 parcels, I'm sure she could do also proofreading for others, yeah? So it's, what I want to say is if you, it becomes much more expensive if you plan your crowdsourcing project with this extra reviewing phase, yeah? But if you, like Wikipedia, you couldn't pay Wikipedia if there would be 20 people or 500 people working on that, yeah? Just to see if everything is correct. I mean, the system is really open, and if there is a mistake, they can change it. And of course, if you have maybe data where death and alive maybe is dependent on it, I would use double keying. But usually it's not that bad. So I clearly say that it is also more motivating for the citizen scientists to know that they are not controlled, but they have the full responsibility, and it's a kind of trust you show to them, and that makes them work much better than if they have the feeling, oh well, someone will look at it anyway. Yeah, and that's also a bit the difference between students and retired people, that the retired people usually work very carefully. And with students, the enthusiasm will go away, and it's not so important for them.
Okay, I've got a question here.
Hi, Gunther. This is a GIS-related question.
Behind this, I mean, that's interesting. The map comes from the ArcGIS server, and probably that's known. It's a big company in the US, which is more or less a monopolist on this. So the data come from the official Austrian cadastre map, and they are completely geo-referenced. And the main challenge actually was the stitching of the single. Of the single images to one large image. Mm-hmm. So they are geo-referenced rather well. Also stitching worked rather well. It was not done by us, it was done by the public agency in Vienna. And we could even make an overlay with the modern data. So that's sometimes we can do.
And how did you manage places that no longer exist or have been completely built over now? So say if the modern GIS says that that's now a reservoir, did you introduce more geographical data into yours, or did you reuse an existing gazetteer? I'm wondering where the place name data came from. You reuse some, or did you create all the place name data yourselves?
Not sure if I understood what you mean. All these data are historical data. And so, but what I can say is that if I would now use a modern layer, it would not be perfect, but I guess with something like 2 to 3 meters difference, it would work. So you could not make really, I mean, these are still legal data. So it's really the first cadastre in Austria, and it has still legal authority. And some people then start to think on borders and so on and sue each other. Therefore, we are a bit careful with the modern cadastre.
Okay, got one more question.
Yes, Gunther. Transcubus has seen a lot of developments in the past 3 years. And we talked about how we 3 years ago were really happy with results that would not be satisfying today. So there were a lot of developments, and you have seen a lot of projects by others. So I was wondering if you could start this project today, would you change anything in strategy or workflow?
Yeah, I would start with the table recognition. That's clear. And the interface itself already has the ability to take the data directly from the page file, the page XML. So if we would now know that this cell is the family name cell, we could also directly integrate it into the form so that the citizen scientists just needs to correct. On the other hand, they often like to transcribe and not to correct. Yeah. So I mean, the writing is okay, and recognition would be good, but yeah, it's also something we learned that they often really like to simply type.
Okay. I don't see any more questions, so it is time for the lunch break then. Again, I think you know the drill. Food is outside for free, of course, and a vegan option is also available. See you later in the afternoon. Thank you.